Hi friends, this is Manoj Prabhakar from Smart Leaders IAS. In this video, we are going to discuss the editorials that appeared in Hindu newspaper in the second week of January. The topic what we are going to discuss now is on adultery. The editorial is titled Not a Criminal Act. See, adultery is defined under section 497 of Indian Penal Code. The Indian Penal Code does not differentiate between theft and adultery. According to Indian Penal Code, the wife is considered to be the property of the husband. So, they have equated adultery and theft. Theft that is related in adultery is invading the property of the man. So, they have kept adultery and theft in the, they have approached adultery and theft in the same manner. Even the legal encyclopedia, like the most famous encyclopedia of Diderot and D'Alembert, equates adultery with theft. And it even terms it as the most cruel of all the theft. And there is one English Lord Chief Justice in 1707, he opined that a man having relation with another man's wife is committing a massive invasion of the man's property. These opinions of invading into other man's property takes its genesis from the Victorian law. In the Victorian law is more backward and it is later, it's a kind of medieval legal system in which the women were treated very inferior and they were considered to be the property of the man. And even now in the modern world, many societies abhor marital infidelity. So, even our Supreme Court in previous cases had opined that breaking into matrimonial home is no lesser than breaking into a house, and it has upheld the section 497. You see the cartoon present in the slide. It shows the implication of patriarchy present in the penal codes all over the world. Section 497 has gendered inequality. What is gendered inequality? See, if a couple, say a man and wife, are in a civil contract, per se marriage is a civil contract, and the woman is having relationship with some other man, only the man can complain against another man. The another man who has invaded into his matrimonial property, that is a wife. So even the IPC considers the wife to be the property of man, and only a husband can prosecute the paramour of his wife under section 198 subclause 2 of CRPC. And also any affair with unmarried, separated and divorced woman does not raise any question of adultery. There are few cases on which the Supreme Court has opined on adultery. One of the cases is Yusuf Asis versus State of Bombay, in which the Supreme Court has opined that Section 497 draws its authority from Article 15 of Indian Constitution, which gives special draws its authority from Article 15 sub clause 3 of Indian Constitution, which gives special representation for women and children. In another case, Revati versus Union of India. In the case, Supreme Court upheld the provision since only the outsider is liable and exemption of women is basically a reverse discrimination in the favor of women. I repeat, the Supreme Court upheld the provision that only the outsider is liable and the woman is saved from reverse discrimination. This is what the Supreme Court opined in Revati case. Marriage is a social process or a social function that is happening from time immemorial. We have many laws, be it Hindu or Muslim or Christian laws, the religious laws mentioning about marriage and adultery. Let's see what the Manusmriti and Sharia speaks about adultery. Manu, the propounder of Manusmriti, proposed heavy penalties for adultery. And he has proposed even death penalty for adultery unless the perpetrator is a Brahmin. The wives has to be treated sympathetically. See, this is a patriarchal point. The wives were not treated to be equal to the husband. They were treated to be inferior. So that was a tribal era. The people were all started being from tribal pastoral people. They got settled and they were developing a civilization. So during that time, at least it was acceptable, but not in the modern time. And the Islamic law prescribes the adultery very narrowly. The definition of adultery in Islamic law is very narrow. It describes adultery as any intercourse outside marriage. So they have mentioned 100 lashes for punishment. And any punishment would be based on evidence of four people, and this is another contentious point. And even other early religions, say Judaism and Christianity, they even have proposed punishment for adultery. And when does this adultery crept into our modern penal code, that is Indian penal code, which was initiated by Lord Macaulay, Thomas Macaulay, in 1833. The first law commission headed by Thomas Macaulay, it didn't include adultery as a crime, and rather it preferred adultery to be known as a civil wrong. But we had second law commission in 1860 by Lord John Romilly, who disagreed with Macaulay. He completely disagreed with Macaulay, and he exempted women from punishment, considering them to be a deplorable condition. Considering the second law commission headed by Lord John Romilly, the second law commission headed by Lord John Romilly, he completely disagreed with Thomas Macaulay's opinion on adultery, and he exempted women from punishment. He exempted women from punishment, considering the deplorable condition of women. This is another contentious point. These provisions of adultery were included in 1860. Now we are in 2018. And it is the time to examine the validity of age-old laws that has criminalized adultery. We have to approach the laws in the basis of progress made by the society. So it is highly a right time to re-examine the validity of archaic laws. See, the image shows the condition of medieval women. The medieval women in Europe. The medieval women in Europe were considered to be too inferior to men, and they were treated like slaves. And this picture depicts that. And now Europe, the cradle of modern civilization, at least after the Industrial Revolution. See, the Europe has moved from being a very medieval society, as we have depicted in the picture here, to a very modern society, by having a modern outlook on adultery. They have adultery is no more criminal offense in Europe. And the US, as we all know, US is a true federal country. They have laws for even separate, every individual state has its own laws, and adultery is only criminal in few states. That too, they are punishable only for habitual offenders and for the people who are publicly notorious. In India, the law commission, which is in India, the 42nd Law Commission in 1971 proposed making the adultery law to be gender neutral and to cut down the imprisonment from 5 years to 2 years. How outrageous it is to imprisoning a person for adultery, which is a civil offense, for 5 years. But they have even cut it down to 2 years, but even that is too outrageous. The 156th Law Commission wanted the legislative to refine the adultery law, but it went for another retrograde step by increasing the imprisonment from 2 years to 5 years, by suggesting the increment of imprisonment from 2 years to 5 years. The Malimath Committee in 2003 proposed a gender-neutral adultery law, and it stood for preserving matrimonial sanctity. Okay. The National Commission for Women in 2006 wanted adultery to be decriminalized. After the wide-ranged arguments in the privacy case, that is the famous Puttaswamy case in 2017, where it was pronounced that individual autonomy and choices are recognized as a part of privacy. I repeat, individual autonomy and choices are recognized as a part of privacy. So, every individual has their own autonomy, has their autonomy, and they can choose their own choices. That is a part of privacy. So, including the matters of private contract, say private contract in the context which we are speaking here is marriage, bringing the divorce, or say adultery, which is a civil offense, which is a breach of civil contract, bringing it under the criminal justice is archaic. And in this pretext, what the author has suggested that making the section that covers adultery gender neutral is alone not sufficient. Based on the modernization that has happened in the society, the Supreme Court should remove the adultery from the statute books of our country. The next editorial which we are going to discuss is, the road still runs through Ramallah. This appeared on 12th of January. This article speaks about the India's relationship with Israel and Palestine. It also discusses about India's major role in Israel-Palestine peace process. Prime Minister Narendra Modi visited Israel on 2017. This was a first-of-a-kind visit made by Indian Prime Minister to Israel. The visit also had many first-of-the-kind. Most of the international leaders, whenever they visit Israel, they make a visit to Palestine. It has been a convention for the international leaders. Even Israel's favorable ally, President Trump of United States, he visited Palestine after visiting Israel. But Prime Minister Modi broke the tradition or convention by not visiting Palestine after completing his Israel visit. So there were a lot of criticisms from the Indian political circles. The government justified the move citing de-hyphenation of Israel-Palestine relation in Indian foreign relation affairs. What is de-hyphenation? The government of India justified excluding Palestine during the itinerary of Prime Minister Modi based on de-hyphenation principle. They stated that India wants to de-hyphenate the foreign relationship between Israel and Palestine. So what is de-hyphenation? To get into de-hyphenation, we should first understand that India has been criticized by many of the Western countries or Western foreign affairs experts, international relation experts, that we hyphenate our foreign relation. What is hyphenation? Hyphenation is involving our ideological thought into foreign relation instead of getting our national priority and global order. Instead of working on priority of the nation, India was working on the lines of political ideology. This was a criticism placed by many of the foreign affairs experts from the Western world. So India broke the ice by introducing de-hyphenation concept. What is de-hyphenation now? De-hyphenation is keeping the interests of the nation. Like India wants to have cordial relationship with Israel for the sake of transfer of technology, be it in agriculture or be it in water resources, and the most importantly, defense exports. India is aware of its choices, so now we have started de-hyphenating the relationship between Israel and Palestine. The joint statement issued after the meeting between Prime Minister Modi and Prime Minister Netanyahu also stated the de-hyphenation principle was also based on de-hyphenation principle. There was not a mention about the two-state solution. There was no urge about initiating the peace process. The major focus of the meeting was on improving the bilateral ties. Improving the bilateral ties was a favorable step for India. See, 41% of the Israel's defense exports are being sent to India. Apart from that, there is a very possibility of deal being signed for spike anti-tank missiles when Prime Minister Netanyahu is visiting India. Apart from arms trade, we have important converging interests on counter-terrorism, agriculture, water technology. These has to be made cornerstones of the bilateral relationship. Agriculture, we all know Israel is located in a dry region. Apart from, we all know that Israel is located in an arid region. They have defied the odds created by geography of the region. India aspiring to double the income of the farmers by 2022 has to invest more on innovative irrigation projects. In that area, Israel can help us. And water technology. Israel is a pioneer in desalination of seawater. So India is looking for potable water. So India has to look to Israel. See, as we discussed earlier, India knows what it can expect from Israel. Even Prime Minister Netanyahu has opined that India and China does not condition. Even Prime Minister Netanyahu has opined that India and China does not look into Israel relationship with the lens of Palestine issue. So this is also a positive sign. Israel wants to improve ties with developing economies like India and China. After Prime Minister Modi's visit in 2017, few significant events happened. It was triggered by US announcement of moving its embassy to Jerusalem. So this was against the previous decisions made by UN, and there was a resolution in UN General Assembly against the move, condemning Israel and US. The de-hyphenation was in limelight during Prime Minister's visit to Israel. Now, when Prime Minister slated to visit Palestine in near future. From Palestine, Prime Minister is slated to visit Jordan, and he is slated to meet Jordanian King Abdullah II. Abdullah II belongs to Hashemite dynasty. Hashemite dynasty is the custodian of the Muslim and Christian temples in Jerusalem. From 1924, they are the custodians of Muslim and Christian religious centers in Jerusalem. One of the prominent religious centers is Al-Aqsa Mosque, which was controversial. In a recent non-ministerial, our External Affairs Minister, Srimati Sushma Swaraj, she stated that India expanding its ties in the West Asian region is going to help the cause of Palestine. So this was also a positive sign from India to Palestine. Also, in a letter ahead of UN International Solidarity Day with Palestine people, Prime Minister Modi supported the two-nation solution and he wanted the early resumption of peace talks. So this was also a positive sign to Palestine from India. Under these conditions, and in the background of these conditions, the author of this article questions whether the de-hyphenation of relationship between Israel and Palestine can continue. We all know that US has recently recognized Jerusalem as the capital of Israel, and it was also, and US has also proposed to move its embassy to Jerusalem, which is against earlier UN resolutions on the issue. And a resolution was passed in UN after the US announcement condemning the action of US and Israel. So India voted for the resolution that is literally against the move of Israel and US. India reasoned that the move was taken on our prior practices, but it is a deviation from our prior practices. Say, at least from 2014, India has been supporting Israeli side in UN by abstaining from the votes. Apart from a vote in 2014, India has been supporting the Israeli cause by abstaining from the UN resolutions condemning Israel. The first one would be in 2015, Israel had launched an airstrike on Gaza, during which around 2,200 people were dead. There was a resolution moved in the UN condemning the Israeli action. India abstained from the vote. This was in the United Nations General Assembly. There was also a resolution passed in 2016. We all know UNESCO is concerned about cultural and heritage sites. There is one important cultural heritage site which is a bone of contention between the Jews and Muslims of the region. There is one mosque called Al-Aqsa Mosque, for which the Jordan King is the custodian, as we discussed earlier. There was a resolution passed in UNESCO condemning the Israeli excesses in Al-Aqsa Mosque. India initially voted for the resolution, but later it changed its stance to abstention. Considering our previous stance in support of Israel, India's recent vote in UN is a shift from our earlier stance. See, the decision was not taken easily. There was a good lobby from USA and Israel for India to vote against resolution. So India had taken the decision against the Israeli and US lobby. Also, many of the countries chose to, even US President Donald Trump, he stated the final status on Jerusalem will be taken only after considering the sovereignty of Israel in the region. So this was a plank on which the US was lobbying, and most of the countries which voted against the resolution took authority from this statement. India's vote in UN on this issue was in this background. This makes our vote in UN a significant move. So there is another important aspect to be noted. Bhutan, which normally goes in line with India's position in multilateral bodies, first time it broke the ranks with India. It chose to abstain from voting. The recent stance taken by India shows India is aspiring to regain its mojo in Israel-Palestine issue. That India is always associated with peace processes in the world, and India wants to reinstate its position as the promoter of peace. This would help in rejecting the false equivalence drawn between Palestine and Kashmir. Also, there are a few comparisons between de-hyphenating the India-Pakistan relationship and Israel-Palestine issue. So this should be our recent move should enable that. Even many of the past leaders of Israel, even including their founding fathers like Simon Peres, founding fathers of Israel like former President Simon Peres, were always supporting the two-state solution. Even former Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin was supporting two-state solution, and he wanted Israel to choose between Jews and democracy. And for this statement, he was assassinated. Recently, our External Affairs Secretary had stated that India is aspiring to be a global superpower. Considering the aspirations of the nation to be a global superpower, India took a right stance by not yielding to the real politic of Israel in Jerusalem. Also, India has to advocate peace process to Israel. This will be a real political calculation for India. This would improve the stature of India in global scenario. The author opines that the road for India's prosperity runs through Jerusalem, that is Israel, but the road for India's global ascent has to run through Ramallah. And the title of the article is rightly named, The Road Still Runs Through Ramallah. The next topic we are going to discuss was an editorial that appeared on 12th of January. The title of the article is The ABC of Right to Education Act. Let's have a brief introduction to the Right to Education Act. The right to education was made a fundamental right through 86 Constitutional Amendment Act 2002. The Article 21A was inserted into Indian Constitution through the 86 Constitutional Amendment Act, and education was made a fundamental right. The Amendment Act necessitated Parliament to make a law to implement the right. Falling in line, a draft bill was introduced in 2005, and the Right to Education Act came into force in 2010. There were a good number of laws existing in different countries, and the best practices from different countries were incorporated into our Right to Education Act. The author feels that there are few important potential provisions present in the Act which needs more concentration, which needs more action from the executive in order to make the Right to Education Act to fulfill its promises. The author feels that focusing on three important provisions of the Act will help in keeping up the promise of Right to Education Act. What are the three provisions? The first provision would be on retention. The second provision would be on pupil-teacher ratio, that is student-teacher ratio, and third would be on decentralization. I repeat, the author has given three important areas to focus. The first one is retention, the second is pupil-teacher ratio, third one is decentralization. Let's have a brief look into these three areas. The first we are going to look into is retention. The Act has provided, the Act has made the provision of education a state liability. The Act has mentioned that it is the liability of the state to give compulsory education to the children, and they should take maximum efforts to enroll the unenrolled students into the schools. Also, the Act has delegated the state government and the local bodies to make the retention. First, the enrolling is done. What should we focus after the enrollment? The next aspect would be on retention. The Act rightly focuses on retention. According to the Act, it is the duty of the state government and the local bodies to ensure retention of 8 years in schools. But this provision of the Act has not gained steam. The educational bureaucracy has not taken any formidable step toward achieving this provision of the Act. We all know that in order to utilize our demographic potential, there should be a skill-developed youth population in India. Where can we get that when the youths are getting dropped out of the schools? So the focus should be on tracking the dropouts and preparing them to the age-appropriate classes. This would mainstream the children in skill development or learning. This would help us to utilize our demographic potential. The author also feels that the school dropouts need more attention than the students who have not enrolled in schools. The government should make strategies to ensure retention. we have been focusing more on enrolling the unenrolled. From there, we should change our focus to ensuring retention. This is an important step, and this should be localized. The strategies that is focusing on improving the retention should be localized. And the next provision of the Act which we are going to discuss is a pupil-student ratio. The pupil-student ratio is an important factor for quality education. There is one particular report, UDICE, that is Unified District Information System for Education. The report, which was taken on 2015-16 year, states that the 33% of the Indian schools are lacking recommended pupil-teacher ratio. And we have introduced many of the forward-looking processes like continuous assessment, no detention policy. Also, we have an significant process called allowing the child to learn at its own pace. These important forward-looking initiatives will lose steam if there is no good number of teachers available in the schools. It was also recommended to make the provision of having minimum of 2 teachers in a school as a basic requirement. There is also a geographical variation between in the PT ratio. See, in Lakshadweep, the PT ratio compliancy is 100%. That is, almost all the schools in Lakshadweep have recommended PT ratio. Whereas in Bihar, only 16.67% of the schools have recommended PT ratio. This is an area of concern. Recruiting more teachers is going to have a great strain on the state finances. But investment in social capital is critical. Critical in the sense, social capital is going to reduce the gap of inequality. So we should invest more on social capital. The PTR compliance is also a critical input for primary education. We have many of the developed countries in the world, they have robust educational system, and the robust educational system were mainly built by the motivated and professional teachers. So no country has never developed a robust educational system without professional and motivated teaching cadre. Few states have more than the recommended teachers, and there should be some rational distribution of teachers is required. Also, the author feels that teachers transfer in many of the states is still remaining a gray area. This has to be improved. Transparency should be introduced in transfer of teachers. The next important provision of the Act is decentralization. We all live in a postmodern world where decentralization is the key to prosperity. So, what the Act is speaking on decentralization. See, the Act wants the local authorities to decide on academic calendar. So whenever there is a function, whenever there is a local festival is happening, whenever there is a harvest festival, we all know India is a diverse, culturally diverse country. We all have different types of festivals happening in different parts of our country. The Act wants the local authorities to decide on the academic calendar. The local authorities, in the sense the Gram Panchayats, that is because we all know, as I said earlier, there are a lot of local festivals or harvest related activities will be happening in the place. The localized academic calendar is need for the HAR, which should be an initial step towards decentralization. Because of that, there would be an accommodative and flexible academic calendar would be made, which would increase more number of enrollment in schools. That's what the author feels. The educational bureaucracy is still lagging in allowing the decentralization to happen as provided by the Act. Dr. Bhimarao Ambedkar has stated that bad implementation of a good constitution will make the constitution bad. At the same time, good implementation of a bad constitution will make the constitution good. Keeping that in mind, we all know the law is too good, but the implementation is bad. So, with the bad implementation, the positives of the law may not be achieved. We should focus more on achieving the positives of the Act. The author is also feeling that open-minded adoption of the provisions, keeping the child's education and all-round development, we can transform our education system in the country. Thank you.